Samules is the head of the Department of French at Yale, and also the director of the Yale program for the study of anti-Semitism. He did both his BA, MA, and also actually his PhD at Harvard, and he specializes in literature and culture of 19th century France and French and Jewish studies. He published numerous articles on diverse topics, including Romanticism, Realism, aesthetic theory, global culture, and writers from Balzac. And I can mention maybe one paper that made a lot of noise called The Trauma on the Boulevard, where Samuels argues against the very common notion of the shock of the big city, the shock of the modernism that we all inherited from Baudelaire, and tries to actually ask what is that terrible if you know we have theaters and operas on the boulevard. How shocking was the shock, actually? So he is the author of three books, The Spectacular Past, Popular History in the Novel in 19th Century France, Cornell, 2004. And maybe the more important book is Inventing the Israeli Jewish Fiction in 19th Century France, where he brings to light the first Jewish fiction writers in France. I didn't know him before he wrote this, but now everyone knows. And the latest book, The Right to Difference, French Universalism and the Jews, is the book about which we're going to hear today. And so the title of the lecture is The Right to Difference, French Universalism and the Jews. And you have the very special responsibility today to give a lecture that is suitable to people with black shoes. And maybe also to lecturers with black shoes. So that you can
go Thank you.
Well, thank you to Liran for this nice invitation, and thank you to all of you for coming here in the rain. And I have never been late to my own lecture before. It was not my fault. It was a problem with the taxi driver. So this paper is from my new book that just came out, as Liran said, entitled The Right to Difference, French Universalism and the Jews. And it's a book about the place of minorities within French Republican discourse, which has traditionally privileged the universal over the particular, which is to say it has tried to suppress minority difference for the sake of national cohesion. This is an issue that has come to preoccupy French politicians, historians, and theorists lately because of the difficulty integrating France's large Muslim minority. But in my book, I show how Jews have long offered the French a way to think through these questions. So that's what I'll be looking at now. On a basic level, universalism refers to the notion that one law applies equally to all people. In France, however, universalism has come to mean not just that all individuals are legally entitled to the same rights, but that the individual must be divested of all particularity, so gender, ethnicity, religion, etc., in order to partake of those rights. Recently, as tensions surrounding the integration of France's Muslim minority have heightened, calls for the suppression of religious and ethnic difference have grown more strident. To hardline universalists, only an ethnically neutral and rigorously secular state can prevent France from collapsing into sectarian conflict. Their principal target is what they call communautarisme in French, which might be translated as communalism or identitarianism, the elevation of minority religious and ethnic affiliation over national affiliation, which the universalists see as the inevitable outcome of American-style identity politics and the main threat to Republican harmony in France. all actors in the current debate seem to agree on one basic thing, that French universalism is fundamentally opposed to minority difference, at least when that difference is expressed in public or political ways. This is the view held by the centrist defenders of universalism who deny the very existence of religious or ethnic communities in France, insisting that the nation is composed only of individuals. It is the view of thinkers on the right who are hostile to minorities and of thinkers on the left who fault universalism for denying minorities a voice. The debate over universalism in France has been framed in such a way that defending universalist values always seems to entail opposing the greater participation of minorities in public life and asserting the importance of national pride and patriotism in France always seems to come at the expense of more particular ties. In my new book, I offer a different perspective on French universalism by arguing three interrelated things. First, I advance the idea that the notion of universalism predicated on the abstraction of the political subject from the particular, which the French associate with the Jacobin revolutionary tradition, is not the only form that French universalism has taken since 1789. I argue that universalism has been subject to debate and negotiation throughout French history and has meant different things to different people in different periods. In other words, universalism has a history, and recovering this history in all its complexity is essential to understanding the pitfalls as well as the possibilities of French universalism today. The second argument I make in my book is that French universalism has evolved in the modern period to a large extent as a discourse on Jews. Despite representing a tiny minority of the French population, Jews have played an outsized role in the French political imagination since 1789, shaping the ways in which universalism has been theorized and implemented. As France's paradigmatic minority, Jews have provided French thinkers with a forum for debating the nature of citizenship and the state, as well as the meaning of Frenchness itself. The third argument I make is that the universal and the particular have often been closer than most imagine them to be. The idea that French universalism demands the elimination of public manifestations of religious, cultural, and what we now call ethnic difference has roots in the revolutionary period, but did not become dominant until the Dreyfus Affair in the 1890s. During most of the 19th century, and at various moments in the 20th century as well, the universal and the particular were often seen to go hand in hand, one reinforcing the other. And one of my goals in the book is to call attention to these earlier models of understanding the place of Jews within the French nation in order to recover a sense of what it might mean to conceive of the particular in universal, to conceive of the universal in particular terms, to see the particular not as an obstacle to universalism, but as a conduit to it. In the remainder of this talk, I want to turn to the revolutionary period, the moment that French universalism was first articulated as a political program and the subject of my first chapter, to see how the revolutionaries treated the problem of Jewish difference. Historians have traditionally traced the fundamental opposition between the universal and the particular to the revolution, and particularly to the revolution's radical Jacobin wing. In fact, the term Jacobin has become a kind of shorthand in French for referring to the suppression of difference that supposedly characterizes French universalist ideology. As I will argue, however, this constitutes a misreading of revolutionary rhetoric. A close examination of the debates over granting Jews citizenship between 1789 and 91 reveals that the revolutionaries, including Jacobins like Robespierre, were far less hostile to Jewish difference, far more pluralistic than has previously been assumed. So to appreciate the nuances of the revolutionary debates over the Jews, it helps to understand how Jews were debated before the revolution. And here it becomes clear that those who defended the Jews or argued for granting them rights in the years leading up to 1789, so the outbreak of the French Revolution, did indeed seek to eradicate Jewish difference through assimilation, or what they called regeneration. One need look no further than the Abbé Grégoire's essay on the physical, moral, and political regeneration of the Jews of 1787, so right before the revolution, the most famous defense of the Jews from the period, for a demonstration of the way that the case made for granting the Jews equality in France was predicated on a desire for them to shed their difference. Grégoire points to all the ways in which the Jews of his day were morally and physically degenerate. He's talking not about the small community of relatively acculturated Sephardic Jews in Bordeaux who had come to France starting in 1492 from Spain, but about the 25 to 30,000 or so Ashkenazic Jews in France's eastern provinces of Alsace and Lorraine, who lived in legally autonomous village communities with their own administrative and legal structures, spoke Yiddish, not French, and engaged mostly in small-scale trade and money lending because they were barred from engaging in most professions and from living in cities. Grégoire, who served as a priest in Lorraine, devotes a large part of his essay to criticizing what he saw as the corrupt economic practices of the Jews, as well as their disgraceful physical appearance. However, unlike earlier Christian theorists who saw so-called Jewish degeneracy as innate and the result of divine punishment for rejecting Christ, Grégoire argues that the Jews' many defects are contingent, the product of centuries of oppression by Christians. He maintains that the ultimate way to improve the Jews, or to regenerate them, in his terminology, is to improve their situation. Before the Jews can gain full equality, however, they must first change, and he advocates certain restrictive measures designed to transform their moral and physical character, such as banning them from financial occupations and eliminating unhealthy kosher dietary restrictions, which he sees as the cause of their sallow complexions and short stature. By encouraging the Jews, Grégoire writes, and I quote, they will insensibly adopt our manner of thinking and acting, our laws, our customs, and our manners, end of quote. So the Jews, in other words, can be incorporated into France because they can be made less different. Grégoire was not alone in demanding the assimilation of the Jews in exchange for rights. Most of the Jews' defenders in the years leading up to the French Revolution, and they were surprisingly numerous, required a similar quid pro quo, although they differed as to which practices or customs the Jews must shed in order to become French, and as to whether the transformation must occur before or after the granting of rights. Some insisted that the Jews must be restricted from all commercial activity and forced to till the soil or become artisans. In other words, they must be assimilated economically. Others thought the Jews must be assimilated culturally by being forced to speak French. Still others, although they were fewer, argued for religious assimilation, either requiring Jews to attend Catholic services or forcing them to convert outright. Scholars have long wondered why so many French intellectuals in the late 18th century bothered at all with the Jews, who represented such a tiny minority of the French population, so less than 0.2%, about 35 or 40,000 out of more than 20 to 25 million French people. Ronald Schechter gives the most compelling answer. The Jews were good to think. They provided philosophers with a forum for debating various Enlightenment ideas. And, as Schechter points out, these ideas were multiple. For some, the Jews provided the perfect test case for the powers of regeneration. If even this most backward of minority groups in France could be transformed by reason, then surely anybody could. The Jews thus became a kind of stand-in for the larger project of transforming the entire French nation that the revolution would attempt to put into practice. For others, however, the Jews, and I quote Schechter, increasingly became good to think about what a citizen was, what a nation was, and under what conditions such entities might come into existence, end of quote. For Schechter, this is what explains why the Revolutionary Constituent Assembly would debate the question of Jewish emancipation on more than 30 separate occasions, even though they had much more pressing concerns to contemplate, like famine, the dismantling of the Catholic Church, and war. Now, I want to argue that with the outbreak of the revolution in 1789, that this marks a dividing line between two different ways of thinking about the Jews. As I just showed, in the decade leading up to the revolution, the dominant approach to defending the Jews was regenerative and sought to transform the Jews into productive citizens through the erasure of difference. Things changed radically, however, after 1789. Later proposals for granting Jews citizenship did not prioritize regeneration or advocate assimilation, but rather used the Jews to define a new type of nation. This new model of defending the Jews was intimately bound up with the priorities of the revolution in its early phase before the radicalization of the terror. The Jews remained good to think, but what they provoked the revolutionaries to think about had changed. This change, I want to suggest, has profound implications for understanding the relation of universalism to minority difference in French political culture. Grégoire himself would modify the kind of argument he made for giving the Jews rights after the revolution broke out. In his motion in favor of the Jews, presented to the revolution's Constituent Assembly in 1789, he dropped his demand for restricting Jewish occupations and explicitly denied that kosher food had anything to do with the question of whether or not the Jews deserved equality. I quote Grégoire, and this is quote number one on the handout. Moreover, what does that dietary difference, meaning kosher restrictions, matter to political tranquility? End of quote. Whereas before the revolution, he sought to force the Jews to change their eating practices, just 2 years later, he expresses far more equanimity about this primary marker of Jewish cultural difference. The methods Grégoire proposes for reforming the Jews also become much less punitive in the later essay. Whereas in the earlier essay on regeneration, written before the revolution, Grégoire had advocated instituting a variety of restrictions on Jewish commerce and banning the Jews from certain occupations in order to push them toward regeneration, in his later motion, he refers only vaguely to the possibility of restricting Jews from holding public office for a period of time. Otherwise, he advocates opening to them, quote, all trades and professions, end of quote. In other words, treating them with complete equality. Crucially, he makes this recommendation not just in the spirit of justice and in the hope of improving the Jews, but also out of a desire to unify France under one law applied universally. I quote, and this is quote two, there is a great advantage in being able to apply the same principles of reform to the whole nation because its character is singular, end of quote. So whereas before the revolution, almost every one of the Jews' defenders had based his case around the need to transform the Jews and recommended explicit laws designed to bring this assimilation about, such as barring the Jews from moneylending, after 1789, the Jews' defenders argued for treating them equally. Special laws prohibiting Jewish commerce became anathema in the new revolutionary context. The Jews must become citizens because all men must become citizens, or such at least was the theory. In practice, as we know, the revolutionaries deemed certain men, such as black slaves, not to mention all women and the poor, less equal than others. To a certain extent, the notion of equality before the law, proclaimed in the Declaration of the Rights of Man and the Citizen of 1789, even if it was not proclaimed with Jews in mind, made the special laws designed to bring about Jewish assimilation difficult to justify, indeed contrary to the new spirit of universality driving the revolution. Now, not all revolutionaries of course, agreed that the Jews deserved to become citizens. The main opponents of Jewish emancipation among the members of the Constituent Assembly came from the eastern provinces where the Ashkenazic Jews resided. They did not oppose Jewish emancipation on religious grounds. Their arguments against extending citizenship to the Jews focused on the threat they posed to the local economy, as well as on their supposed unassimilability, their obstinate refusal to join the nation, which basically came down to a refusal to eat with Christians or to marry them. The most extended revolutionary debate over Jewish emancipation occurred in late December 1789 in the context of a larger discussion about admitting non-Catholics to all functions of citizenship. The discussion centered ostensibly on Protestants, who were the most numerous of the non-Catholic groups, but also touched on other dissenters whose actions or beliefs kept them outside the church, including actors, executioners, and Jews. These groups had been excluded from elections in certain districts and denied appointments to government positions on account of old regime or pre-revolutionary laws. Complaints and confusion ensued. The assembly now realized that it needed to make explicit exactly which men were in fact equal before the law. And it soon became clear that Jews offered the real sticking point. Now, several important orators participated in the December debate, including Robespierre, although Grégoire notably remained on the sidelines. The most famous intervention, and the most rhetorically astute, came from the Count Stanislas de Clermont-Tonnerre, deputy from Paris, in what would later be known as the Speech on Religious Minorities and Questionable Professions. Clermont-Tonnerre's speech represents one of the clearest formulations of the logic for granting Jewish equality that the West has produced. It is also one of the most misunderstood. Far from implying that the Jews must assimilate in order to merit citizenship, as many have taken it to mean, it relegates regeneration or assimilation to the realm of an irrelevant side effect of the main proposition of proving the reach of revolutionary universalism. Clermont-Tonnerre begins by denying the need for such a speech at all. The language of equality enshrined in the Declaration of the Rights of Man and the Citizen should make it clear, he says, that all men deserve equal rights. The nation has the right to establish a national religion and to ban those who do not practice it. But a nation that allows for religious liberty and does not have an established religion cannot then subject religious minorities to discrimination, even if this discrimination takes the milder form of toleration. For Clermont-Tonnerre, including the Jews among the citizens of France was essential to defining the nature of this nation. It would be secular, but it would also be unified. There would be no middle ground, to use his term in quote three, no special laws applying to certain categories of citizens. Clermont-Tonnerre makes this principle essential to the new nation's legal identity, the core truth from which all other laws flow. Clermont-Tonnerre goes on to address the various objections raised by the critics of the Jews, that they form a nation apart, that they possess their own autonomous communal institutions, that their religious laws and customs prevent them from mixing with other Frenchmen. As for the last of these objections, Clermont-Tonnerre points out that French laws do not require people to share the same table, nor do they compel one person to marry another. The state, therefore, cannot punish the Jews for following customs that are not prohibited and that do not infringe on the national welfare. We may hope that the Jews will cease to follow their outdated customs once they become citizens, he says, but they are not, and this is quote four, offenses that the law can and must reach. In French, des délits que la loi puisse et doive atteindre. And they are not, therefore, obstacles to citizenship. This phrase is crucial to my argument that the revolutionaries were more pluralist than has previously been recognized. Jewish cultural and religious practices for Clermont-Tonnerre have nothing to do with whether they should become citizens. Like Grégoire in his motion, Clermont-Tonnerre holds out Jewish assimilation as a possible goal, but he does not make it a precondition for granting citizenship. The question of Jewish communal autonomy is another matter, however. Here, he's categorical. The Jews must give up their separate laws and judges before they can become citizens. And I quote what's the most famous line of the speech, which is quote 5, "To the Jews as a nation, nothing. To the Jews as individuals, everything." This famous dictum has been very often misunderstood. As David Sorkin has shown, it did not mean, as many later interpreters would suggest, that Jews must cease to identify with other Jews, that they must assimilate, or that their Jewish identity must become a purely private individual affair. It simply meant that the state will not recognize the Jews as a corporate or legal entity, just as the state will not recognize other corporations, including guilds or the Catholic Church. Supplying the sentence that followed that famous one helps clarify the parameters of Clermont-Tonnerre's proclamation, and this is quote 6. "Their judges should not be recognized. They should only have ours. No legal protection must be given to the maintenance of the so-called laws of their Judaic corporation. There must not be any political body or order within the state. They must be citizens individually," end of quote. The liberal deputy insisted that in exchange for citizenship, the Jews must recognize only the laws of the French government, or in other words, they must assimilate politically. Notably, he does not deny the Jews a group or communal identity, but he does maintain that the kind of community that had previously defined the Jews, which was at once religious, cultural, and legal, must change. From now on, the Jewish community in France must be only religious and cultural. There would no longer be a legal definition of the Jew in France. Note the imperative nature of Clermont-Tonnerre's speech. All the times he uses constructions like "there must" and "they should." And note that he is not speaking of a hypothetical future, but rather using the present tense. He is not only laying down the principles for the fair and equitable treatment of minorities, he's conjuring a new nation into existence through the very force of his logic, through his performative speech act. Other defenders of the Jews in this December 1789 debate would similarly couch their arguments in both moral and practical terms. For Robespierre, the Jews must become citizens because to keep them apart would violate the laws of justice and compromise the long-range goals of maintaining national harmony. I quote Robespierre, and this is quote 7, "I think that we cannot deprive any individual of the sacred rights that the title of man bestows upon him," end of quote. For Clermont-Tonnerre, likewise, the justification for enfranchising the Jews was a question of instituting the most rational social formation. I quote him again, and this is quote 8, "It is repugnant that there should be within the state a society of non-citizens and a nation within the nation," end of quote. The continued existence of the Jews as a separate entity, subject to different laws, was less a moral outrage than an offense, I think, against his legal sensibilities. David Bell, a historian at Princeton, has described how the revolutionaries forged a new type of nation. They created the idea of a nation defined by ideology rather than by blood or ancestry. According to Bell, the efforts to regenerate supposedly backward groups like the Jews form part of a much larger plan to remake the entire nation along revolutionary lines, to inculcate in the entire population a devotion to common national ideals and to instill in them a common national culture that would transcend or really supplant regional differences. Belief in this vision became the main criterion for citizenship. This new vision allowed for religious and ethnic difference to persist as long as it could be subsumed to a higher ideological commonality. I would like to suggest that the debate over the Jews was one of the key moments in which this new idea of the nation took shape. We've already seen how Clermont-Tonnerre conjured a new idea of the nation in arguing for Jewish equality. It is a nation with a single law for everyone, although there would still be restrictions based on property for voting and holding office, as well as certain restrictions based on race and gender. Perhaps more importantly, though, his speech also describes a nation based on ideological affiliation. This becomes plain when he answers the objections of those opponents of Jewish emancipation who claim that the Jews don't want to surrender their communal autonomy, that they constitute a nation apart, that they long for a return to Jerusalem rather than to be a part of France. Well then, Clermont-Tonnerre says, and this is quote 9, if they don't want to be citizens, let them say so and let us banish them. One might easily overlook this line in Clermont-Tonnerre's long speech, particularly since it seems on the surface to contradict the generous and inclusive terms of the rest of his discussion. Actually, though, it represents the speech's essence. The liberal deputy is proclaiming that Frenchness will now be defined by voluntary affiliation, by adherence to an idea of what the nation should be. Those who don't want to participate can leave. Mirabeau, another revolutionary, would argue something similar in the debate over the Jews the next day. I quote Mirabeau, and this is quote 10, in a government like the one you are building, it is necessary that all men be men. It is necessary to banish from your breast those who are not or who refuse to become so, end of quote. So Jews, but by implication anyone, must choose whether to become French. Frenchness, then, is a shared idea. And in this sense, it is a universal right, available to all who claim it, at least in theory. In practice, as I've said, the Constituent Assembly at first made active citizenship only available to white men of a certain economic status. Nevertheless, the implications of this new definition of the nation were profound. It included the Jews, or those Jews who wanted to be included, and it turned out that nearly all of them did. But it excluded those who did not accept the new parameters of nationhood, such as aristocrats opposed to the revolution, whose ancestors had defined Frenchness for centuries, but who would soon find themselves forced to flee the country. Jews, moreover, served as the limit case for conceiving of the nation along these new ideological lines. Because of their very strangeness, their cultural and religious difference, their position on the literal and figurative margins of the nation, they became the symbol of what it would mean to conceive of the nation as a primarily ideological entity. This, I believe, was why revolutionaries like Clermont-Tonnerre bothered to defend them in the first place. And this was why the Jews' difference became actually valuable to the revolution. Rather than trying to assimilate it away through regeneration, they needed the Jews' difference to prove how inclusive, how universal they could be. Other scholars, as I've said, have argued that the Jews offered the Enlightenment a test case for the powers of regeneration. According to this view, the Jews offered the model for what the philosophers expected of all Frenchmen, transformation into a new kind of enlightened, rational citizen. And here, too, the Jews' initial difference from this ideal made him the perfect symbol. The Jews' supposedly retrograde customs and obstinate obscurantism made regeneration a challenge, but also showed its potential powers. If the Jew could transform, then anybody could. I am arguing, however, that once the revolution got underway, this imperative faded before a new one. The Jew now offered revolutionaries like Clermont-Tonnerre a way to describe what France itself should be. The debate over Jewish emancipation allowed the revolutionaries to outline the contours of a new kind of nation. This nation needed regenerated citizens to populate it, but I think it's important to note that the formation of the nation envisioned by Clermont-Tonnerre did not require assimilation to succeed. unassimilated Jews could still be part of the nation he imagined, provided they agreed to abide by French law. Clermont-Tonnerre pays lip service to the idea that Jews will one day assimilate by ceasing to follow their supposedly outdated customs, what he calls their religious oddities, their travers religieux in French. But he notably does not insist that the Jews cease to follow customs that do not conflict with French law. I quote, and this is quote 11, "Certainly these religious oddities will disappear. And even if they would withstand both philosophy and the pleasure of finally becoming real citizens and sociable beings, they are not offenses that the law can or must reach." In contrast to the imperative tense that he uses in the rest of the speech when describing the new nation, he employs here the more hypothetical future tense, will disappear, to indicate the possibility that the Jews will change, a probability that requires the qualifier certainly to render it more likely, and then the conditional tense, would withstand, to indicate the possibility that they might not. I want to insist on this conditional because it indicates the extent to which the entire process of regeneration had become secondary to that of redefining the nation. It is surely significant that the logic for emancipating the Jews still holds, even if the Jews fail to change their manners and customs. Of course, they must agree to legal assimilation, to abide by French law. But the various religious oddities that constitute the bulk of the Jews' difference, including their linguistic, dietary, and vestimentary peculiarities, which the Abbé Grégoire had tried to modify, become irrelevant for Clermont-Tonnerre. Not only is economic, cultural, and religious assimilation not a prerequisite for participation in the new national body, I would argue that it is not even really a goal at all, despite the conditional lip service that Clermont-Tonnerre pays to it. This is because the Jews' difference had now become desirable. It allowed the revolutionaries to articulate their universalist vision. Theirs was a nation that would include a group even as different as the Jews. This was a regeneration of a different, almost opposite kind. France, he says, might or might not transform the Jews, but the Jews most certainly would transform France by helping to redefine what it means to be a citizen and what it means to be a nation. Now, Clermont-Tonnerre's speech has long been misinterpreted, as I said, as demanding that the Jews abandon their religious and cultural identity in exchange for citizenship. Even a defender of Republican Universalism, like Robert Badinter, subscribes to this view. It is the whole doctrine of assimilation that is expressed there by Clermont-Tonnerre, he writes. A notable exception to this historical consensus is Phyllis Cohen Albert, who has argued persuasively that not only was assimilation not required of the Jews, but it was not really pursued by the majority of them either, at least not to the degree that has normally been supposed. 19th century French Jews, she argues, maintained a high degree of ethnic identity with a low rate of conversion and intermarriage. But if French Jews did not see their emancipation as entailing an obligation to assimilate, I'm arguing that many of those responsible for granting them citizenship impose no obligation of this kind either. Even the arguments made on behalf of Jewish emancipation by Robespierre, the future Jacobin leader, make no reference to economic, cultural, or religious assimilation. Indeed, the version of universalism invoked by Robespierre in his argument for granting the Jews citizenship is one that implicitly contains the possibility of including difference. I quote his speech, which is quote 12, "All citizens who have fulfilled the conditions of eligibility that you have prescribed have the right to exercise public functions," end of quote. What he means is that there cannot be separate laws for separate categories of individuals. Difference cannot disqualify someone from citizenship. Or to be more precise, since eligibility to vote or hold public office was in fact dependent on economic status, he means that only economic differences must be allowed to count, and that cultural and religious differences of the Jews are not disqualifying if the Jews have met financial requirements for citizenship. The debate in December 1789 did not resolve the issue of Jewish equality. The Constituent Assembly voted to lift restrictions on all non-Catholics with the exception of the Jews, about whom they reserved judgment. Emancipation or citizenship eventually came a short time later in two separate decrees. A first one in January of 1790 applied only to the more acculturated Sephardic Jews of the Southwest. A second decree on September 27, 1791, enacted right before the Constituent Assembly disbanded, extended citizenship also to the much larger group of mostly unacculturated Orthodox Yiddish-speaking Jews in Alsace and Lorraine. The fact that the deputies returned to the question of Jewish emancipation before their business could conclude indicates the extent to which certain members of the Constituent Assembly felt that something consequential for the nation rested on the fate of the Jews in France's eastern provinces. As one of the deputies in favor of emancipation put it to his fellow deputies, as he tried to force a vote for Jewish emancipation, "I demand that we proceed to a vote without listening to those who want to speak against this proposition, because to combat it is to combat the Constitution itself." And this last speech was decisive. The measure passed before any of the opponents could speak out against it. The fate of the Constitution, which is to say the fate of the revolution and its radical reorganization of the state, was thus described as contingent on the emancipation of the Jews. As I have argued, this was because the Jews provided the revolutionaries with a means to articulate what the new state should be, which is to say, secular and ideological, rather than Catholic and corporate, based on voluntary affiliation with an idea rather than ancestral ties of blood. This is not to say that all those who sought to emancipate the Jews acted out of a democratic impulse. As Schechter has shown, many of them were quite undemocratic in their willingness to restrict citizenship to wealthy white men, and they may have used their generosity toward the Jews as a cover for their elitism, for their unwillingness to extend the franchise to the poor masses. It's not a coincidence, he points out, that the grand gestures of inclusion made by the Constituent Assembly to minority groups, including Jews, Protestants, actors, and executioners, were toward groups with very few members. Emancipating the Jews ultimately changed very little in practical terms, especially since a very small number of Jewish men would have been wealthy enough to immediately qualify for active citizenship. But if the practical import was slight, the symbolic import was great, and not just as a cover or alibi. The revolutionaries really did redefine the nature of the nation by including the Jews within it. It's significant for my argument that the only demands placed on the Jews as a condition of their emancipation in the final decree were that they renounce the privileges and exceptions that had formerly pertained to them, that they take a civil oath of allegiance to the state, and that they promise to fulfill all the duties imposed on them by the Constitution. This amounted to a renunciation of their former autonomous status, and the Duc de Broglie insisted that such a renunciation be made explicit. But if political assimilation was therefore required, no mention was made of economic or cultural assimilation, much less of religious assimilation or conversion. Regeneration was not even raised as a desirable outcome in the final debate over emancipation. To be sure, some of the members of the Constituent Assembly may have continued to believe that the Jews must change and perhaps voted for emancipation based on that belief. And it's also true that certain French Jews would interpret their emancipation as a mandate or as a pretext for change and would pursue a course of assimilation in the centuries that followed. But it's important to note that the terms of their emancipation did not require them to do so. An anecdote recounted by the historian Gary Cates illustrates the extent to which at least some of the Jews who received citizenship understood it in these non-restrictive terms. And I'm getting to the end here. When the following year, after the vote to give the Jews citizenship, the Jews of Nancy in northeastern France swore allegiance to the regime at a public ceremony, as they were required to do,
Bear Isaac Bear, the lay leader of the Jewish community, made certain to profess his loyalty to France, but also to declare his loyalty to Judaism. Each of us will naturally follow the religion of his father, he stated. Thus, we can be loyally attached to the Jewish religion and be at the same time good French citizens, end of quote. This Jewish leader saw no compromise as necessary.
In the nearby village of Bischheim, however, the Jews were told by local leaders to cross themselves when they took the oath of citizenship. They refused and appealed to the departmental directory, which sided with the Jews. When they next attempted to take the oath, the crowd demanded that they remove their hats. They refused to do so. Once again, both sides appealed to the departmental directory, and once again, the freedom of the Jews to follow their own religious laws, if these did not conflict with the civic duty, with their civic duties, was upheld. The Jews of Bischheim succeeded in swearing allegiance
explicitly to France and implicitly to Judaism on April 30th, 1792. Moving now to the conclusion, I want to suggest that identifying the openness to minorities, the pluralism, at the source of French universalism might help the French move past certain impasses in political discourse today. I think this perspective offers a corrective to critics who assume that French universalism is inherently hostile to difference. These include critics on the left, such as Wendy Brown, Joan Scott, and Etienne Balibar, who oppose universalism because of its complicity in colonialist and neo-colonialist forms of domination. Balibar describes the hypocrisy of the country of human rights, meaning France, attempting to educate the human race while simultaneously, I quote, assimilating dominated populations and differentiating individuals or groups according to a hierarchy based on their aptitude for or resistance to assimilation, end of quote. While I agree with his analysis of how French universalism has often functioned in racist and exploitative ways, I take issue with the idea that French universalism is inherently racist and exploitative. What I object to in this critique is the tendency to reify or dehistoricize universalism, taking its worst manifestations as illustrations of a fundamental tendency, and ignoring various forms of resistance to this dominant model. I believe it is important to call attention to more pluralist articulations of French universalism, not because these visions have often prevailed in French history, but because they offer the possibility of saving what is good about universalism, of separating out universalism's contradictions in order to retain the ideal of justice at its core. But I intend my book mainly as a response to today's hardline universalists, such as Alain Finkielkraut, who sees the French Republic as imperiled by assertions of the right to difference. In his recent book, L'identité malheureuse, so Unfortunate Identity, of 2013, Finkielkraut defends the ban on wearing the Muslim veil in French public schools by distinguishing between the French Republican model of citizenship and the pluralist model that obtains in most other Western countries. French identity, according to Finkielkraut, relies on a form of universalism that others, and by others he means mainly Americans, just cannot understand. He looks back nostalgically to his own experience in French public schools in the post-war era, in which the rigorous refusal to discuss difference allowed him to succeed, in spite of the fact that his parents were Polish Jewish immigrants. As he would have it, the current effort to coddle minorities by emphasizing difference in public schools has undermined this once robust vector of equality, condemning these groups to a permanent state of inferiority and turning the nation itself into a battleground between minority communities, each competing for recognition. Finkielkraut's perspective overlooks the fact that the secular schoolroom is itself a relatively recent invention in France, and that other models for inculcating Frenchness and managing inter-ethnic conflict thrived in France before the end of the 19th century. Defenders of a hardline model of French universalism often complain about Americans telling the French how to solve their minority problems. Not only is America's treatment of its minorities hardly a source of inspiration, they point out, but Americans never seem to grasp how and why French universalism and laïcité, or secularism, evolved as they did, in large measure as a way to free France from the grip of the Catholic Church. So to be clear, I am not advocating the grafting of an Anglo-American model of liberal pluralism onto the French context. On the contrary, my book shows how various models, French models, for integrating minority difference have existed within French culture since the time of the Revolution, even as more rigid notions of universalism came to prevail for specific historical reasons. As I've tried to show here today, a certain strain of French universalism has always acknowledged the possibilities of the particular and has always fought against both the right and the left to allow for difference within it. I'll conclude with a reference to another recent theorist, Jean-Claude Milner, who has explained that we need to distinguish between what he calls the easy universal, invoked by thinkers as ideologically opposed as Alain Badiou and Alain Finkielkraut, a universal modeled on St. Paul, on the repression of all forms of minority particularity, and what he calls a more difficult universal, one derived from particularity and that takes difference into account. Whereas various forms of the easy universal, including Marxism and Maoism, European progressivism, and American liberal pluralism, have failed to prevent violence and persecution, the difficult universal has the potential to act as what he calls an obstacle to the worst. According to Milner, such a difficult universal would seek in minority difference the ground for a more inclusive form of universality, one that does not demand conversion or conformity in return. This is the model of a universal that I have tried to locate within the French tradition itself, stretching back to the time of the Revolution. Recovering this tradition, I want to suggest, is a necessary first step toward articulating a difficult universal today. Not only is the time ripe for the thinking through of the difficult universal, Milner tells us, but the return of violence against Jews and other minorities in France and elsewhere obliges us to such a thinking through. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Yeah.
Wonderful talk. So I open the room for questions, and if some of you want to ask questions, we'll meet you, and so that is also possible in the practice. So.
Hello, thank you very much.
Yeah.
I wonder if you took into account when we were analyzing the discourse of the Jewish minority in France before and during the Revolution, you took into account the religious conflicts between Protestants and the Catholics and what this impact had on the story about the Jewish minority?
Yes, that's a great question. And I mostly left that out of the talk because, you know, really, you could say that the Jews got citizenship as a kind of byproduct of the debate over Protestants. So they were, as I mentioned, the same debate in which Clermont-Tonnerre gave that famous speech was really a debate about Protestants, although it included these other groups like actors, executioners, and Jews who were, you know, a tiny minority. And that was really what, you know, most of the conflict leading up to this was about, you know, and that, as you say, had gone on throughout French history. So, you know, you could argue that the Jews, as I said, the Jews got it because they had to give it to the Protestants. So they had to make a kind of exception for people who weren't Catholics. But what I try to show in my book is that Jews represented a more problematic form of difference to than the Protestants did for the French. And that was why Protestants were basically accepted unproblematically even during that revolutionary debate. So they vote to give it to Protestants and they wait on the Jews. So they can't quite get around to accepting the Jews. And that's because Jewish difference was seen as more different than Protestant difference. But as I also try to show in the book, Jewish difference was seen as less different than, for instance, black difference or gender difference. So women couldn't be really conceived of as equal because in a way you couldn't even conceive of women changing to become more like men. And the same thing with black slaves. So what's kind of interesting about the Jews for the French is the nature, the very specific nature of their difference. So they're both different and not so different. And their difference is changeable. Like you can imagine the Jews transforming in a way that you can't imagine these other groups. So what I try to argue is that they, rather than Protestants and rather than blacks and women, become the focus of these debates throughout French history because of that very particular nature of their difference. But certainly, I don't want to argue that the Jews were more important historically than Protestants, certainly, or blacks or Muslims today. I mean, Jews were, you know, a very, very small minority. And it's not like this had any major actual practical effect, as I said, for most people. But I'm trying to argue that they play this interesting role as a kind of paradigm.
It's interesting that today within the Jewish community, I mean, it's undergoing very profound changes because of immigration to Israel. And it's interesting that it's the assimilated Jews that immigrate actually, it's more like the Orthodox Ashkenazi group immigrates less. And more assimilated than Sephardic community, let's say, if you can make these distinctions, immigrants more, that's interesting.
Well, thank you. So that is one of the things I try to trace in the book, is what changed. So how, if I'm trying to argue that in the revolutionary period, they were much more pluralistic than we now assume, how did we get to the point now where it seems completely normal to ban the veil? So that is really the main question I look at in the book. And what I argue is not what went wrong, but in a sense, what went right. Because really, it was the Dreyfus Affair that in the 1890s that changed things. So the Dreyfus Affair, which I'm sure you all know about, where a Jewish army officer was wrongly convicted of selling secrets to Germany, became, you know, a kind of led to a sort of civil war in France, pitting the partisans of a kind of right-wing anti-universalism against the defenders of Republican universalism, among whom were famous intellectuals like Emile Zola. The Republicans win that battle. So Dreyfus is finally exonerated and pardoned. But the result of that was a hardening of the notion of universalism that leads in 1905 to the what they call the Loi Combes, the Combes Law, which separated church and state in France. So prior to 1905, the laïcité, so secularism, did not mean the radical elimination of religion from the public sphere. In fact, secularism, and I'm not the first one to say this, there are historians of laïcité who have argued this, it meant the equal treatment of France's three major religions, which at the time were Catholicism, Protestantism, and Judaism, to the point that in 1831, France treated them so equally that it put rabbis on the state payroll, and the state paid for all Jewish religious costs. I know of no other Western country in which that was the case. And that lasted from 1831 until 1905. So religion was not banished from the public sphere. In fact, the French government paid for Jewish religious schools. It paid to create build these monumental synagogues that you see in every major French city. That all changes in 1905. But apparently, according to these historians of secularism, even at the beginning in 1905, it was still not as hardline as it is today. It's becoming more and more hard line. And then as to the question of immigration from France, my understanding is that it's not, I mean, you know, there's, you need a sociologist, I think, to, you know, answer this question of who exactly is immigrating. You know, France, as I'm sure you've probably heard, has become the leading country of people making Aliyah now, which has never been the case. France was always, you know, very few French Jews relatively came. And now it's apparently up to like 9,000 a year, so like, you know, you can get really good croissants. And I, in fact, had that. Some of them are going back. I think a lot, okay. You know, my understanding of who is coming is that it is mostly Sephardic Jews and, you know, by Sephardic, I mean Jews, not the Sephardic Jews I'm talking about in my paper, whose families fled 1492, but Jews who came from North Africa following decolonization to France, not necessarily, as you said, the Ashkenazic Jews, definitely not the descendants of those Alsatian and those, you know, who are now very well integrated in France, nor really the descendants of the big wave of immigration from Eastern Europe in the 1890s to 1920s, but it's mostly Jews, and there are many, you know, I've read different explanations of why it's mostly the Sephardic Jews coming. One of them is that they have a longer history of living with Arabs and are, you know, possibly more, and many of them live actually in closer proximity to Arab groups and are, therefore, they're more likely to be the victims of anti-Semitic violence there. So there are different explanations for that. Yeah, I mean, it's really an interesting question. So, you know, what I'm trying to argue, I think that's the implication, is that the French would do well to look at these debates over, you know, what Jews were required to do it during the revolutionary period. So the fact that Jews, in that example I gave, were not required to take off their hats in order to become citizens. That was at the very moment of the French Revolution. So it's ironic to me that people now are arguing that that is what the revolutionary tradition requires of Muslims, is, you know. So, you know, I understand that things change and that there are various, you know, that there, you know, you could argue that there are new, you know, circumstances. And I'm not someone who doesn't understand where the French are coming from with that, you know, with these, you know, laws, you know, to force integration. Like, I understand, and I don't want to condemn them as Islamophobic. I don't think necessarily, I think some of them probably are, but I don't think that that's necessarily the goal, or certainly not what they see as the goal. I think they see the goal as, these people are not becoming French. They don't feel a link to France. And we can't have a country where people don't feel part of the French state. And I'm sure they would argue that it was fine to let the Jews keep their hats on, because in fact the Jews went through a whole process of becoming French and feeling this sort of identification with France that Muslims, you know, according to these people, are not. And it's partly, I think, because, you know, the numbers are so Jews represented 0.2%. Muslims in France are 10% of the population now and growing because French, you know, birth rates are declining. So I do understand where they're coming from, and I don't want to condemn them as all Islamophobes. I just think that it bears in mind that universalism is a more flexible and complicated question than some of them assume it to be.
Was it really clear to everyone over the discourse and the discussion that the Jews were white? And the Jews, you said the good Jews were good to sing with. Why weren't the black slaves and the gypsies good to sing with?
Yeah, well, that, so there, you know, there have been people who've worked on, you know, this question of race. And this was the period when, you know, early notions of race were coming into being. But race itself hadn't, you know, it was really the second half of the 19th century when modern notions of racial science and discriminating and creating a hierarchy of races were really hardened. And I should say that Jews themselves used the term race starting in this period because, you know, there were a lot of Jews who were beginning to, or really a little bit later in the early 19th century, who were not religious, who nevertheless felt a kind of connection with other Jews and were looking for a word to kind of define it. So it was a kind of ambiguous category. But this is something that the Abbé Grégoire is very interested in. And in fact, he is also, it's not a coincidence that he's the leading defender of blacks also. So he also argues for giving, you know, against slavery and giving blacks rights. But he does have a whole idea of regeneration and assimilation through mixing of races. And he seems to think that Jews, this will happen much easier and faster. I think he thinks that it could eventually happen with blacks, but it would require intermarriage and things like that. So I think he definitely sees the Jews as, you know, less racially different than blacks. But it's a very complicated question of this whole kind of history of races and how, you know, these ideas, and these ideas are in flux precisely in this period. Yeah?
Do you find any comparisons of Jews to gypsies? Because there are similarities
in them. Yeah, you know, I wasn't looking for that. I don't think France has that many gypsies in this period. You know, later in like 1830, so not that much later, Victor Hugo's novel Notre Dame de Paris is about a gypsy, but it's a kind of, you know, fantastical, romantic kind of idea. So I didn't really see, you know, too much about gypsies.
I like very much your lecture because you brought to us a few quotations, making very clear the different nuances about the discourse of universalism toward equality. And one of them is written, and you talk about it, is when there must not be any political body. So the discussion around giving rights to the Jewish community, one of the conditions is to banish any political issue around the Jewish community as a religious community. So if you take these assumptions to what happens today, it is clear that it is not the same. I mean, obviously, what's going on is religious community, including the Jewish community in France, and of course the Muslim community too, is a question on the degree of political dimension within the communitarian phenomena of today. So it is absolutely not the same
in my opinion.
Yeah, I mean, that's the real issue, you know. So what, when the French attack this notion of communautarisme, so communalism or identitarianism, you know, what do they mean here? And it's not as clear, certainly, as it was in before the French Revolution, where the Jewish community had a legal definition and they were part of this, you know. So part of what I tried to argue is that the revolution got rid of these communities and made legal definitions of the Jews problematic in France. So now, today, I would say that's still the case to a certain extent, that there is no legal definition of Jews. So for instance, in France, until Vichy, you know, there was no, you didn't have Jew written on your passports, there was nothing like that. That was what was so, you know, horrifying about Vichy, was that for the first time the Jews were identified as Jews, and that was seen as a kind of complete rejection of French republicanism. So now, the question is today, well, what is communautarisme? So what, how are these people acting? Are they acting in political ways that are contrary to French republican identity? And of course, even though some French people would deny it, there is an organized Jewish community in France. There's something called the CRIF, which, you know, speaks for French Jews, and French politicians are forced to go to the CRIF dinner every year, you know. So there, you know, you could argue that. But I think what the French really are angry about is not so much those political, you know, bodies, but this idea of identification. So that they see, and I think to some extent they're right to see this, that Jews and Muslims in France are identifying more with their communal group than as French people. And I think that that is deeply worrying, and that's what's occasioning this debate. And it's very clear, I mean, there have been a lot of sociologists and historians who have pointed this out in the Muslim community. You know, there's, I mean, you could read, you know, there's a book on the lost territories of the Republic about how in French public schools, Muslim students reject, like, you know, don't want to learn French history, say they're not French, and, you know, but there recently was a Jewish American sociologist who wrote a book about how French Jews are increasingly feeling that way too in France. So, you know, I think that's the real issue more than the, I don't know if that answers your question.
French Revolution was a fight against the religious number, the typical number, like meters, instead of mile or instead of feet. And the weight, kilogram, etc. And the days of the week, they pronounce that the week is 10 days. So most of the measures, public cut it, today we use this number, but the middle of time, about the week, after 3 years, Napoleon changed it back. And because it's too much for people that they believe that God created the earth with 7 days, they couldn't change it. So even the French Revolution could be flexible in this, but in other that sticking there.
Yeah, well, that you bring up a really interesting point, which is important to emphasize, which is this debate about giving Jews citizenship is coming in the context of the radical rejection of the Catholic Church from French life. I mean, that is an unbelievably momentous change. And they tried to eradicate it even in these symbolic and, you know, getting rid of the days of the week, you know, getting rid of changing the calendar, changing all of these things were part of an effort to completely change the culture and to remake a new kind of modern citizen. And it's important to see this debate about giving Jews citizenship as part of that. And that came along with real hostility and violence and persecution of Catholic priests, for example, who were much more persecuted in this period than Jews. Although, in fact, the violence against Jews that really happens in the revolutionary period, a lot of it is against Jews as a religious group in the way that Catholics are being persecuted too. So that's a very important context, I think.
Okay, thank you very much.